WLFE-DB Radio has LGBTQ shows like Across the Pond, Rainbow Soul, Everything Yet Nothing, and Inside the Drag Closet. Check out the schedule on WLFE-DB.com. You can even watch them on TV at WLFE-DB.com under LGBTQ Friends, right off our website. Again, it's WLFE-DB.com for your LGBTQ shows and more.
WLFE-DB.com, where talk radio is a whole lot better. Our shows are your shows, and that there makes for a great talk radio. Oh yeah, life just got sweeter now that WLFE-DB has merchandise. Show your support by purchasing your t-shirts for WLFE, Paratalk Radio, Inside the Drag Closet, and more. But it doesn't stop there. T-shirts, coffee mugs, tanks, buttons, cloth bags, and more. Go to WLFE-DB.com. On the top bar, click on the merchandise tab, and bam, there you go. You got merch. Support the shows. WLFE-DB.com.
Hey, I'm Hollis Taylor, and I'm a non-binary person. And I call myself a Divine Anderton. I guess it would kind of be like saying that you're a monk or a practitioner of magic or something like that. Maybe it depends on what path you walk. See, one of the things I noticed as I started to come out and started to identify as non-binary, I started to realize that there was no spiritual path for people like me. Like, I mean, there were some things, like indigenous people, but I don't want to culturally appropriate. I didn't grow up on a reservation. And I think Two-Spirit is great, and I want them to keep it. And I felt like I had to define my own path because I didn't have a huge background in these things. And so I started to explore things. And of course, some religions shame us, right? And then there's some religions that don't even include us, like Wicca. I went to many rituals and never, not once, did they mention someone that was both or neither gender or god or goddess, unless you asked. And then they would often have a goddess or something. But there was no language for it. And so as I started my own spiritual path, my own path of holistic learning, I learned that I really needed a spiritual path in order to be who I was. Like, I felt like it was part of humanity. It was part of being a human. And I needed to be celebrated in my spiritual path. I needed to be seen. And I didn't want any of the shame. So that's not for me. That's theirs. And so as I started to unfold, I started to realize that I have my own path. And each one of us actually do. You do. Everybody does. Has their own spiritual path that they're to unlock. Your authenticity is in your heart, just like it was in mine. There were some things I had to go through to unlock those keys, to get closer to who I really was inside. Because all of us are divine conscious beings, and you have to work through some weird stuff sometimes, like cultural norms, gender roles, and gosh, mental health and the crap your parents programmed in there. Sometimes we have to unfold that out. And when we do, we get to an authentic surface, authentic person when we move through those surface things. And when we find our authenticity, we can go deeper. We can love deeper. We can love ourselves deeper. We can love other people deeper. And we can enjoy our life fuller and more and feel more complete by the time it comes time to, you know, end. Because we all die. None of us get out of alive. So, just consider as you start to identify and find your gender is not something that was given, that is not something that was assigned to you when you were born, as you start to realize your gender expression, no matter what it is, I'm talking to the drag queens, the drag kings, the gay guys, transgender people, non-binary people, gender neutral people, all of us, we're all here for a reason. The divine sent us here. We're all here to define our own path, make it what it is. Follow that part of you that doesn't follow the rules, the part of you that doesn't do what other people are doing, because that part of you will lead you to the path you need to be on, and you will manifest the beautiful things that the world desperately needs. All of us are where we need you. We need you to step up and bring your most beautiful light to the world. And I hope that that's what this book does. That my book, Divine Androgen, A Sacred Path for Gender Variant People, and this channel will inspire you to find out who you are and open it up to the world and deliver it as if we were all waiting for it, but we didn't know what we were waiting for exactly. Show us what that is.
Welcome to Rainbow Soul, part of the WLFE-DB network, an explorative discussion about spirituality beyond mainstream religions. Hollis Taylor, author, psychic, astrologer, and alchemical mage, brings their non-binary perspective together with fellow drag king and trans man LaCrosse Ortiz, a Jewish Taino with spiritual background of exploration that has led him to an atheist perspective. Join these guys as they explore deep and difficult topics, all related to spirituality, offering a queer perspective, an exploration of interesting topics, and engaging guests to help explore conversations for the rainbow soul.
Hello, 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 and welcome to Rainbow Soul. I'm so glad you're here, and I'm glad you're watching today because we have a beautiful special show for everyone today. And I want to say that I'm Hollis Taylor, and I'm host of Rainbow Soul. And today I have a special co-host, in case you are aware of them. Her name is Bright Hawk. Welcome, Bright Hawk. Hey. I'm so glad you're here.
Good to be back. Good to see you. How's everybody?
Yeah, we're really good. And so first I'm going to start with, I'm Hollis Taylor, and I am the author of Divine Androgen. It's a sacred path for gender variant people. And it's a special book about defining your own path as a gender variant person. And today, Bright Hawk is here. Tell us who you are, Bright Hawk.
Well, I am the author of The Dancing Hippo, which is a wonderful book illustrated by Amanda Moore. She was on the program last week, and it's just incredibly beautiful. And it's also a book without any gender pronouns. So I believe that every child should see themselves in every character. It's a story about resilience. It's a story about shining your light. It has some great messages. And if you get the ebook, it also has a bunch of music as well.
So, it's a really special book for sure. And welcome. I'm so glad to have everybody here. Welcome, Eric.
Hey.
And Eric says hi to you, Bright Hawk. And welcome, Sandy. It's good to see you. And sorry, LaCrosse isn't here this week, but he had something come up. So it's the two of us. And welcome, Andrea. I'm glad you're here. I'm so glad you're here.
Nice.
I want to say that, like, today's show is really special, Bright Hawk, because for me, one of the things that I even talk about it in my book is how music actually changes me. Like, there were times that, you know, I was having a crappy day. Come on, we've all had a crappy day, right? Or feeling really sad. And even times that I was struggling with cutting and suicide and things like that. And I found music, I would even listen to, once I figured out what was happening, is I would listen to super dark music that would help me unwind some of that crappy feeling, those feelings of suicide and cutting and things like that. And I would listen to those songs, that music, and then it would kind of unfold things for me. And then when I was ready, when I felt like I had processed enough of it, I would actually consciously choose another song that was a little bit more positive that would help me transition into a different emotion or change my experience. So I actually used music like a form of therapy. Exactly, Sandy. That's exactly what I did. Exactly. And I find that, like, for me, music is just spectacular in that way. And I know, Bright Hawk, music is special to you.
Well, I've been a musician since I was a child, and I can't imagine life without music. And I thought everybody had that experience. I thought, especially during our teenage years, right? Use music to soothe your soul, you know, take you on any, whatever emotional journey you needed to go on. And that music has a way of transporting us in so many ways. And I thought everybody had that. I thought everybody did that. And 10 years ago, maybe, I met somebody who said, I didn't grow up with any music. Our house, we didn't have the radio on. We didn't have music. We weren't allowed. And I was like, what? And I never forgot it. I walked around thinking, that's child abuse. I couldn't imagine robbing my soul of that experience of music. Music is so integral to my soul. And I assumed, because, you know, whatever's true for us, we normalize, right? We believe, oh, everybody experiences it this way. And they don't. But I think music is very special. And it's one of the reasons why, you know, I volunteered as a hospice musician. That some of the most profound music I've ever played in my life is been in service, in spiritual service. And I think any artist, when you have that experience of the flow, there's a certain releasing and letting go into the creative process of just like, okay, play me. Let me just be your instrument, spirit, just play me. And if I can take people with me, transport them, and in the experience of playing in hospice situations where you're the last thing they hear, you're the magic music carpet ride that just leads into the sunset, you know, and it's such an honor to be able to play like that and to play in that sort of, it's such a release experience. It's such a letting go of like, okay, I'm here to serve and do whatever is required, you know, play me while I play, you know what I mean? It's a weird, I'm sorry, words fail when it's so deeply spiritual. It's such a spiritual experience. But I know every artist, every musician, every artist, I'll leave it at artist because I think you can experience writing. I think you can experience it in painting through whatever your creative expression is, that there's a flow that we get to where we truly are greater than the sum of our parts. Like, wow, I don't know where that came from, but I'm so grateful it's coming through me, you know? So that to me is the journey, is part of the, is the, to be in, I'm going to call it spiritual service as a musician or as an artist. It's very special. It's an honor.
There is some magic in the music, and Brighthawk and I used to go to nursing homes and help. Brighthawk would play the handpan, and I would dance with the elderly. And that the dance process is inspired out of music. And I'm also a tap dancer, so I've also had spiritual experiences where I've actually had to get out of the way. And so I get what you're saying there. I don't actually play music other than tap dancing. But there are times that you have to like kind of get out of the way, like your own, because otherwise you'll be thinking about shuffle step all day. And so you don't want to be thinking about that. And so instead you just kind of back up. And the next thing I know, I was having more of a spiritual experience, like you said, where the divine comes through you. And so today, so my big challenge though, here was my big challenge. How do you find a non-binary musician? Like, I mean, you know, that would be willing to be on the show. Like, I know a lot of musicians. I really do.
You really do.
Because of Brighthawk. I know tons of them. But all of them are, they might be allies, but they're mostly cisgender. And I thought, at least for the first time that we have a musician on, the person should be non-binary or trans or at least queer. And so I was challenged, and wham, I found one. And I was like, well, I don't know if they'd be willing, but I could, doesn't hurt to ask. And so today's guest is totally amazing, Autumn Haw. I'm going to welcome Autumn out to the show. Welcome, Autumn.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
It was me giving you a drum roll. welcome.
Hi. I'm so happy to be here.
So, Autumn, tell us about like who you are. Tell us about, you have 2 albums. You've won some awards. Tell us about that.
I've come a long way. Well, I started playing music when I was really, really young. I grew up in a really musical family. My mom played music all the time and played guitar for a lot of the... We grew up in, like, religious backgrounds. My mom was always a youth pastor or leading music in some way. And then I left the church, like, at, like, 19 and continued kind of doing my own stuff. And it's just been a bit of unraveling from that past up until who I am now. I've been queer my whole life. Like I have memories of walking around and talking to my sibling and be like, I wish I was a boy. And Kyle would go, oh, I wish I was a girl. And we'd be like, haha, this is normal. And just like never really like brought it back up in my brain ever again for a really long time. I started going to therapy at a place called the Gender Health Center here in Sacramento. And they're one of the most like extraordinary places pretty much ever, like other than another place called NorCal Resist, which gives aid to people in like a really real community-based and oriented and founded way. Gender Health Center has been like the reason for the season for me being healthy and me understanding my identity in a stronger way. And oh my goodness, I don't know about y'all and when your coming out happened for you in your life path, but for me, when I came out, I just felt like you just kind of feel like you have permission all of a sudden, as if you haven't had permission before. And I don't feel like I am second guessing everything I'm saying or feeling like I have to hide anything or pull back on anything or pretend to be something to make other people happy. And not only that, but like, I think maybe you start to attract the same people too. So at this point in my life, I'm queer. I'm non-binary. My pronouns are she, her, they, them. And right now I'm going by Autumn, but then close friends also call me Otto, just for fun. I've been trying that out like the last couple of weeks, and I don't know. I think one day I was like, man, I wish my name was Otto. And my friend was like, it can be. Like, you don't have to wish. I don't know. It just, it never dawned on me to push myself to like experiment in that way. But yeah, so I'm experimenting with like an additional name or not too. Anyway, yeah, I play music and I'm really, really glad to be here. Thank you guys so much.
Well, thanks so much for coming. And I just want to say that like, it really was a challenge to find a non-binary musician. The world's not crawling with us.
That is so strange. It's so strange to me. You're like, where are, maybe they're all in California. I was like, I think I know at least a few, but I am in California, so.
Right.
Yeah. I'm from California. We live in Colorado, but I'm originally from California.
Oh, Colorado is so beautiful. Is there a big social difference between California and Colorado as far as like acceptance? And is it like a little more dated other than like the community itself?
As long as you're in Boulder or Denver, you're fine. Boulder is actually more accepting than any city I've ever seen, even in California. Because Boulder is a small college town, and you can go into the grocery store and be like, they, as you're checking out, you know, someone would say, oh, I want to help you, ma'am. And you could just correct them. No, it's they. And they'll be like, oh, I'm sorry. And then you'll get they the rest of the time. And they're just, and they're really... They're just totally respectful. They don't look at you funny or anything like that. I can go out with my t-shirts that say things like they, them to Boulder. And it's totally, I can't think of a place in California that was that comfortable.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I've been to like LA and San Francisco and stuff, San Francisco, but it's still, yeah, Boulder's just a different town.
It was a better place, I think, maybe like 10, 15 years ago. And then right about now, it's kind of techie. And, you know, you kind of can't live there unless you're just like extremely lucky or you have a lot of money. Most of the queer community, not those people, especially in art community. I don't know about y'all's art community, but typically we're not the most financially set people. I'm very happy. I don't know, don't put words in y'all's mouths, but I'm very happy how I am. But I'm also, I don't have a lot of money either. I couldn't like go live in San Francisco. Sacramento is supposed to be one of the most diverse places. I read that and I was like, really? It was like, I don't know. It's like my idea of diversity is like, has a higher standard than that. I'm like, okay, I guess I can see like there's different communities and stuff like that, but I would still like there to be more unity and like it to be safer. You know, I don't think it's like Boulder at all. A grocery store clerk would definitely be like, ma'am, and not, you know, and I pretty much just accept it because I was like, I don't want to make anybody mad at me.
Well, you should try it out. I've done it in California and got away with it. In here in Boulder and Colorado in general is pretty accepting. And I'll tell you, when I moved from the East Coast, to Boulder, it was definitely a little bit of like, whoa, because the East Coast, our viewers are from the East Coast, is very like, people don't want to hear about your pronoun. It's just not part of the culture. There are some parts, if you deep in the city, that it could be okay, like New York City or Philadelphia and places like that. And you can go to a queer bar, and of course there it's okay. But But yeah, so Colorado is very accepting, like super accepting as long as you're in the cities. But it, you don't want to go anywhere else. And, you know, the country is sort of filled like that. I would say the most accepting city I've ever been to is Portland. So, but as far as music goes, for me, I was like, I mean, I know Bright Hawk, but I've had Bright Hawk on the show. And the great thing about Bright Hawk is not only is she a musician, but they also tell stories at the same time. And so it's really beautiful.
It makes sense that you'd be good at that.
Yeah. And so, and you know, they're an excellent storyteller and using the handpan with it is extra special. And I wanted to also bring on some other people that we hadn't met yet. And it definitely was actually like I Googled it. And you know, there's obvious stars that we could accuse of being non-binary, but they like Prince. Okay. So, you know, Prince came across to me as a non-binary person. I've always seen Prince as a non-binary person.
Oh, yeah, me too. But he definitely didn't want people to like put him in a box. And like, I feel like he himself, like maybe with his close friends, would be on that thing. But he was in the 1980s. Like, it was a.
Right. And I think also, like, the issue sometimes that happens is fame. So fame, and although that's changing, I suspect that managers and when you become famous as a musician or whatever, they start to pressure you to make some choices that may not be aligned with who you are. And that's an unfortunate thing. I hope that changes.
Yeah, big time. It's so funny. Like I just sing how I sing, you know, I sing how you talk and I don't think about it. And I can't really hear myself sing, but when I was really young, the first recording experience I ever had, the person who was recording me kept going like, could you sing more like pretty? Could you sing like more feminine? And I was like, what does that mean? That's first off, that's very vague feedback. And secondly, like now looking back, I'm like, oh, you know what? That should have been like the first sign. You're like, what do you mean? I'm not coming off as like 100% feminine. I don't know anything.
Wow.
Okay.
And I think that I appreciate musicians that are. Really, really unique and unusual. That's one of my favorite things about Bright Hawk. And what I appreciated about your music, Autumn, one of the things that I was really intrigued by was by the lyrics. I felt like some of the lyrics in your songs were really talking to people that really struggle with mental health. And to me, that's really special because then you're working it. That's a special kind of magic that I call healing. Mm-hmm. And when people get to listen to your music, they heal. So when you, did you write the lyrics for most of your songs?
I wrote the lyrics for all my songs. Yeah. Yeah.
So some of the songs that, you've written, the Anxious Mind.
Oh yeah, Anxious Brain, my anxious brain and my broken heart.
Anxious Brain and my broken heart.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that must have been like a big, because I struggle with anxiety and I think many of our viewers struggle with anxiety as well.
Yeah.
And so if they can check out that song at some point, I think that's really awesome in that way.
That was a big breakthrough. For me, like not the song itself, although I really like the song itself. What I usually do with songwriting is I kind of treat it as if it was a therapeutic process. And anytime I make like a big, like kind of self-discovery, I'm like, oh, I gotta write that down. And so all the songs are just like little self-discoveries of like where I'm currently at, basically just like check-ins with myself. And that was a song I'd written where I was like, it's really, really complicated to exist as a human being when you already have things to deal with and you already have self-responsibility for your actions and your feelings and being able to process that on your own time. And then have other things to deal with on top of that, responsibilities, you know, responsibilities to your friends, your family, to your workplace. And then you just throw in like, your heart is broken and the world's on fire. And everyone's just like, handle it. And you just sit there like, this is really heavy.
Yeah.
It's really heavy.
Have people ever told you that before, that listening to your music has helped them through something?
Every once in a while you get somebody who's like, oh yeah, this really helped me through a dark time personally. And that's really nice, because you never want, you know, the music you're making to just be all about like myself, you know. It's so nice when like it reaches other people and they interpret it in ways that like, you know, mean something to them. And that's really cool. I love that music is like kind of like a healthy cycle of like, you know, someone breathing and somebody exhaling. And anyway, it's all nice.
So have you found it like to be, as a musician, have you found that when you're writing or playing the music or whichever, that you connect with a spiritual side of yourself? How does that unfold for you?
Oh yeah. Big time. Well, first of all, I just want to like jump in and say to Brightlock that I love that you brought up that you worked as a hospice musician, because I did too for quite some time. And I've grown up in a family where my dad has a brain degenerative disorder. And he's had that for a really long time, and we've known about it for basically our whole life. So like we've been having to like mentally wade through that and like make sure the rest of the family is doing okay with it. And it's a whole thing. And then I started working at the hospice place. They had me come and do music every 6 months for like 4 or 5 years. And it was such an incredible community. Like I think also like as a older in life care, specifically because of my experience there, like it was so heavy and was so sad, but like it was really deep and really meaningful, and it meant something really special to get to be with a group of people who wanted those people's rest of their experience to be like as gentle and as lovely and as full of good food and full of good people and getting to see their family like as humanly possible, you know. Yeah, that was like a big spiritual breakthrough for me too, because I was having a really, really hard time processing what was happening with my dad. I'm like one of the only people who was like, I actually had a really good relationship with my dad. So it's not daddy issues for me personally, although that's very valid for many other people. Yeah, it's just hard for me to like see him struggling, because he was a really gentle person in my life. Like I think maybe I kind of like decided I could do whatever I wanted to do because my dad never said that I couldn't. It was like the one like male person I was growing up with was like being really open with me and letting me be whoever I wanted and not forcing like femininity on me. So anyway, it messed me up forever. I love it. It helped me sort through those really, really hard and dark and sad feelings in like a really healthy way. Cause every time I was showing up and singing and everything else was crying and processing through what was happening to them, I was crying, processing what was happening to me. And it really helps me, like, you know, I'm in therapy and stuff like that too, which is why I can talk about this stuff and not be blubbering and all over the place. But oh my gosh, like they're the most wonderful people ever. So I'm glad that you brought that up because it's all connected for me.
I agree. I used to be a hospice nurse, and that's how I ended up working with people with dementia and stuff.
No way.
Yeah, and that's how we started Let's Dance. That just like the process of working with them helps you work through your own personal stuff.
Yeah,
really. It's a really powerful experience. And being a deaf midwife, being at the side of someone's bed, even while Bright Hawk was playing handpan and I'm helping them move on, was a really powerful experience that it opens your heart and soul. And you also have a realization of your own death.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
inevitable. Mm-hmm. None of us get out of here alive. So I found the whole experience. I think that people with dementia, a lot of the times we had a great time. They often seen me as a young boy. They did not see me at all. They would say, "Are you a boy or a girl?" And I'd say, "Does it matter?" And they'd think about it for a minute, and then they'd be like, "Nah, not really," because I guess at 90 it doesn't matter. And Bright Hawk played the music, and I danced with them and interact with them one-on-one.
Wow.
So people with dementia have a special place for me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and I think music, I think the profound truth about music is that it's vibration, right?
Yeah.
All music is vibration. And so they say, especially in the hospice experience, that hearing is the last sense we have. And so and I think that's because it's vibration. And one of the Let's Dance programs we did, you know, we would put everybody in a circle and ask for name tags so Hollis could greet them in a very friendly way, and which worked great because sometimes they didn't know their own name. And we were in the East Coast, perhaps, and we did 500 shows in 39 states. I don't always remember where were we. Speaking of dementia, they asked, "Can we? Is it okay if we bring this woman in who is deaf? She loves to dance, but she can't hear you." And I said, "Yeah, keep her close." And she could. She could feel the vibration, and she loved dancing with Hollis, and at a certain point broke out and spoke in her own way that she could hear me, and that she was having a profound experience. And that's the kind of stuff we live for, right? You know, to be able to open up someone's awareness. And the handpan was always really fun because, you know, to have a 90 or 100-year-old say, "Well, I've never seen anything like that before," you know, and you're like, "Yeah, I know." So that's the music to share with you, you know? And that was always, always felt like a plus factor. And this was the mind-blowing part. We knew about the dementia studies. We knew about people respond to music they're familiar with. I would see it with my own parents, put on something that they loved and they'd just light up. But I'm playing all original music. Everything I play is, of course, composed by me. So none of it's familiar to them.
Mm.
We would go to places, we would go around the country and then come back to certain places. And what was mind-blowing to me, we are visiting memory care units. We would come back the next year and they would remember us. "You were here last year."
Whoa. Oh, you know what it is?
I didn't know. I'm like halfway through the show going, "This looks so familiar." And you know, the places are designed to look familiar. And all of a sudden you're like, no, no, we've been here before. And they're telling me, no, you've been here before. And I was like, wow, this is something very cool. That was the point about with COVID shut us down. I kept thinking we should partner with somebody who could actually measure this stuff.
Mm-hmm. There's definitely a documentary I've seen on Netflix. I think it's about Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
And it's about music therapy and Alzheimer's, and music connects to a different part of the brain usually isn't affected as much. So because there's music involved, they have a higher ability to remember. And that's also why, like, you will hear a song you heard when you were 8, and just like start crying. Cause you're like, I'm 8 years old and feeling feelings again. And it just like, it's like a rope through your whole lifetime. Just because of the vibration, the vibrational aspect of it.
And that you're 100% correct that mm-hmm. music bypasses the broken part of the Alzheimer's brain. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing that we realized was because I'm sort of sing-song storytelling and playing my music in rhythm and time and just making it like this, people who couldn't understand regular speak understood me. Sometimes it also worked in reverse too. It's very difficult as a musician, as you know. This is a rip your heart out moment as a musician when somebody is looking at you like this. Because Alzheimer's brain, you yeah. sound like wop 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 wop.
Mm.
So I had a whole experience as doing this on a regular basis that just taught me over and over about the humility, the humbleness of the artist, you know, and the more you just went in with just a very low key, you know, I'm here to just be of service, the better it went. Anytime you thought it's going to go great, I got this, man. You can have your head handed to you.
I think being a performer, I mean, as a drag king, you know, performing can be more difficult than it looks.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've had your experiences, Autumn, where
look easy or like it's not easy. They're just extremely good.
Yeah, sometimes performing can be kind of brings up anxiety, eh? And can make you anxious and questioning yourself. Yeah.
Because it's bright.
Right, exactly. And I think it's just part of doing it. But I think if you have performed and then you're the audience for someone else, mm-hmm. you tend to be more aware that they're probably going through something and then you want to help them. Mm-hmm. And I think the fun thing about music though, is that it erupts. Like I've been in spiritual rituals, ceremonies with music.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And there are songs that have erupted emotion within me. Yeah. I'm not always saying it's great emotion, like I'm cheering for joy. Sometimes it's emotion like, oh, wow. Like I've even had songs hit me in a flashback to mm-hmm. cults that I've been part of. Mm-hmm. And now this group is singing a similar song or the same song. Yeah. And I'm going, oh, my goodness. I'm not in the, and I have to actually talk myself out of it.
Right.
It's almost like your brain remembers the music, even if you don't consciously remember it.
Oh yeah.
Have you ever, I'm sure, well, in church, you've had some spiritual musical experiences, right?
Big time. And it's tough because sometimes I'll be walking around and be like, doo, 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 doo. Where's that song from? And I'm like, uh-oh. I know exactly where that song is from.
Right, exactly.
Brain, I'm like, what a jam. Except for I don't believe anything it's saying. except for that part. Yeah.
Yeah, I imagine that. I don't know how you felt about your church. What kind of church were you part of?
Well, we were in at least 12 or 13 different churches. They were each separate denomination. So depending on which church we're currently in, my parents moved a lot when I was young. Depending on which church we were in at the time, they were either like pretty okay. Like there are definitely churches I've been to where like they accept all minorities, they accept all people in the LGBTQ community, but those are like far and in between, you know. The majority of them were very like anti-woman. You had to have permission from a man that was in charge of you for you to be able to do anything artistic, anything musical, anything like in the community at all. Pretty much had to be co-signed by somebody that was a guy. It was weird. And there was a lot of, I found that like as a kid, I was very susceptible to just whatever anyone told me. If they were like this, this, and this, and I'd be like, hell yeah. And just believe it, like no issue. A part of that is just because I was on the spectrum for a long time and didn't know. I'm from a family of 7 kids, and there's like 3 or 4 kids in my family that have autism, and I'm on the spectrum, but I have low support needs, basically. I'm like one of the couple of people that like discovered during COVID that I'm on the spectrum and that I'm also like more gay than I thought previously and like more not into my gender than I thought previously. Like a lot has come to fruition. I wanted to believe the best in everybody, and I had no reason to think otherwise. And I was just like, I don't know who you are, but you're telling me what to do, and I'm just gonna go with it and believe it. And that's really tough because I soaked up so much of that, and it took me a really long time to be like, is that my opinion, or is that the opinion of somebody that I was like pseudo afraid of and felt like I had to believe to impress them? And it took me a long time to not constantly be seeking validation of like some man in charge somewhere. But you know, come see. Yeah.
So did you like, you know, you had the Christian, I'm assuming most of the churches you went to were Christian. Yeah. And then did you have like an awakening later? And was it like, did it lead you to any other spiritual paths? Did you explore any other religions or?
My parents wouldn't let me stay at the house because I believed in gay marriage when I was in high school. And like, I wasn't even out at the time. I was just like, well, that's weird. And later on, I'm like, I mean, there was a good reason, good ally. But I basically was on my own at a really young age and kind of just trying to explore as much as possible with the free time that I had been given that I wasn't kind of expecting. Just trying to live and survive, you know, but that helps a lot, actually. I was reading a lot and I was listening a lot, and I was trying to spend time with people that I, you know, looked up to and admired. And it helped a lot to get into the queer community in the last couple of years. That's been like the last 6-7 years for me. Finding the queer community was like a big catalyst for me personally. Like it gave me a lot of people to look at and be like, okay, that's totally how I want to live my life. And like freaking taking notes over here, like, let's do it. Let's do it right now. And it's made me more empathetic. It's made me basically force what used to be like a really introverted person to be able to vocalize what I believe in and, you know, stand by all the things I'm vocalizing, not in like a combative way, but also not in an apologetic way. I think that, you know, a queer me deserves to have a nice, happy, peaceful life, just like everybody else that I know. And I'm supportive and protective of that person.
Well, I'm glad that you're at least open to exploring your spiritual path. I eventually found Wicca or witchcraft and nature-based spiritualities, which really inspired my heart and my soul. And of course, alchemy and things like that. So I found that spirituality was a huge part of being queer. It's just that it just so happened that Christianity made it out to be like it was a sin.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But in reality, if you went to other religions and other spiritualities like Wicca, witchcraft, nature-based, all kinds of nature, alchemy, things like that. Even alchemy itself talks about androgyny as a sacred.
Mm-hmm.
It's as sacred as an element, I suppose, or as a divinity. Yeah. So, and that's kind of like my ultimate mission in life is to spread that message that even though Christianity says that being queer is bad or sin or whatever, mm-hmm. the opposite is true. Mm-hmm. Every other religion that you explore mostly. And so it's like, you don't have to listen to them. By the way, come on over here.
Oh, yeah.
And you're awesome.
And being queer has existed for so long in pretty much every other community, and every spirituality and every path has accepted it for a really long time. And it's only recently that folks have like tried to be super negative about it. I don't know. It's a whole mess, but it used to be great all the time and we're getting back to it now. What part of being Wiccan for you, in your practice as a talks about the divine androgyn?
Okay, so it broke up a little bit because I don't know your internet connection or something probably, but their divine androgyny, I sort of made that up because divine is mm-hmm. what we talk about. I actually got it while I was praying. I was doing yoga. And it said, you're going to call the path that you're defining the divine androgyn. And in Wicca, though, there are tons of, I couldn't even go into them all, of gods and goddesses, or sorry, not gods and goddesses, deities, which are, mm-hmm. They're not a god or a goddess. They are both. And that's actually quite common in alchemy, which is an understudy of, I wouldn't call it Wicca, although a lot of people from Wicca end up in alchemy. It's just, alchemy is a spiritual path. It's considered where you take your lead and turn it into gold.
Right.
Okay. So you take your sadness and turn it into a way to help others overcome their sadness. Okay.
See, I love that. See, like when you describe what those practices actually are, I mean, it sounds like what people describe as like the baseline for what they're trying to do with lots of religion. You know, you're trying to take sadness and turn it into joy. But everybody was like, no, you can't be in that club. You got to be in my club. It's the only club that counts. And like, just like, negatively describes everybody else and like tries to give them bad press or whatever, but like I've gotten like a little bit into deity work and a little bit into like I'm like a garden witch, but they're so similar. I'm like, I literally just like talk about like things that I want to do in the future and like try to set intentions, and I try to be, you know, like what the things I say, I try to hold my standard too, you know, pretty much. That's it. And
yeah,
they have so much in common. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much what alchemy is about, sending your intention and going for it.
That's right.
Sometimes we have all night fire circles where people play music all night long.
I love it.
She's kind of a veteran or an elder or a person that's been in it for a very long time. And so she's one of the drummers. She plays djembe. And yeah.
And so what I was thinking about when you were talking about your path with Wicca was my awareness of, it's so funny because back in the 90s, we didn't even have a language of queer. But for me, I remember my first event that I went to, that it was a really big, it's a very open, but primarily pagan event. You know, the rituals were primarily pagan. It was intro to me because I was drawn like a moth to flame because of the music. So I come in with my drum and I'm like, well, what's all this stuff, you know? And I'm like, oh, you need me to play for the ritual? Okay, yeah, I'm a drummer. I could do that, you know? And then I'm like, oh, that's ritual. It's kind of cool, you know? I call in the elements and, oh, and started to become aware of this very vast, very old tradition. You know, they call it the old ways for a reason. Mm-hmm. And that music was a huge part of it. So for me, the two came together very simultaneously at the very same time, because I literally remember on the drive to the event thinking, you know, I don't think it matters who you love, what their genitalia is. I think it's about love. Love is love. I think it's about souls finding each other. I don't get what's a big deal. I hadn't been in a relationship yet that way. But this was cracking open really long held beliefs, because in addition to being from California, my friend, I am also the youngest of seven children.
Oh.
And a recovering Catholic.
Oh, you're the baby?
Oh. Uh-huh.
We love our baby.
Yes, that's right. Let me entertain you.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that checks out.
Yeah. Sag, of course. So, and I used to think, and I still do believe this, that when we sing authentically, when we really open up and sing, whatever it is, a chant, a poem, it doesn't matter. You can be an om. That you can't open your vocal cords that way without opening your heart as well. I don't know how you would do that. I don't know how you could separate and not do that together. Mm-hmm. So to me, that's always been, you know, there's reasons why the monks chant and om, and why that centers us when we're meditating, and, you know, how, again, I think it comes back to vibration. You know, if you're having a hard time, if you take a conscious breath and then ohm to the next breath, your state, I promise you, will change. Mm-hmm. It is scientifically proven that if we take that conscious breath and then ohm into the next breath, we will change from who we were three breaths ago. It's as simple as that. So that music and spirituality, I can't separate them. They go together in my brain and in my soul, in my heart, you know, in my experience.
Yeah, it's beautiful. They do often sing songs around the circle, around the alchemical fire circle. That's probably about half to three quarters of the experience throughout the whole all-night circle. Is that you sing songs. That's the idea.
Yeah.
So I want to speak to this. Eve said, I'm deaf, though I have memories of when I had more hearing. My relationship with music is more vibrational and tactile interaction with some reading of words. That's beautiful, Eve. I think that's beautiful that you can even tap into that memory of what music was like and bring that in for you now. And I think that's what was happening with that person in the home that we visited when she was having a profound experience of hearing the handpan. It was, I think it was the first time she had heard music since her hearing had gone.
Right.
So she wasn't aware that she would ever be able to hear music again.
Or I wonder if you maybe you're reading like a particular kind of poet who uses like a very lyric-y style of writing that maybe like when you're reading it kind of sways in that way, and that will kind of be like listening to a song again. Maybe that's what they meant by music. I don't know.
Yeah.
One of my first early experiences when I had gotten my djembe and I was in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and I used to go to the Cambridge Hospital to the children's unit, and I'd offer drumming and tell some stories. And again, the vibration, everybody got into it. The kids would totally get on their feet and dance and totally get into it. And you never knew who you were going to see, what their condition was. It was a hospital. So every week it could be the same kids a couple times in a row, which then you'd be like, whoa, this kid's been here for a month. But most of the time was a new kid. And one of the times I'm drumming and I'm playing, and there's an autistic child rocking totally into the rhythm. And I'm like, cool. And I go to put my drum down to start doing the storytelling part of the show. And the kid's like not having it. And very vocal about that's not okay. That is not okay. So I was like, oh, okay. So improvised in the moment, put the drum back on and slowed it down so I could sing and talk and do a rhythm that I could maintain and tell a story and figure it out. And there's something that happens to our brains as musicians. They can actually do an MRI of us, those of us who have been trained classically, that if you've done music for any length of time with any kind of discipline, our brains look different. Our left and right hemispheres are integrated in a way that if you did an MRI of somebody's brain who was not a musician, it wouldn't look the same. And it's because of that integration that happens. And you know what it's like when you're playing music and then putting the words on top of it. And if you have a particularly complicated pattern, being able to sing through that section is probably not a good idea. Like play one thing and keep it simple when you're talking. There's this thing. And then finally your brain gets it. And all of a sudden then you can just do it. And you don't have to think.
You don't think about it. And you're like, but like a second before, this is very complicated. And now it's like, you know, I'm sleeping through it. No problem. It's wild. And especially when you're like starting to learn guitar too, there's a definite part where like your vocals and your guitar work are completely separate things. Yeah, and doing them both at the same time feels so uncomfortable and clunky in your body. And then one day it just integrates and you don't even know when it is, and like your hands stop moving, and it just all kind of like decides that, oh, we like it now. And it's really, really special.
Well, I think our audience can identify Robert White from Australia. He's saying, I hear music is stored in another section of the mind, which I'm pretty sure that's what we're talking about here. And John is saying music is deeper than awareness, which I agree. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to take a little commercial break.
Okay.
And when we come back, first, Bright Hawk is going to... normally we would have a dream interpretation, but Bright Hawk is going to offer us a song. and I think that would be great. And then when she's done, we'll have you out, Autumn, and you offer whatever it is, whatever you're inspired to play tonight. So I'm going to invite everyone to take a little break and go get your drinks and go get what you need and come back and enjoy the music.
Yay.
WLFE Digital Broadcast Network is on TV. You can watch all of our shows on WLFE-DB.com. Check out our channels. Paranormal View for all of your paranormal type shows. LGBTQ Friends for all of our LGBTQ shows. Variety Unlimited for all other shows. It runs 24/7 right on WLFE-DB.com. You'll even catch the lives all in one place. Never miss an episode, past or future. WLFE-DB.com, where our shows are your shows. Search for your favorite shows like Where's My Sage, Inside the Drag Closet, Across the Pond, Everything Yet Nothing, Paratalk Radio, Step Into the Paranormal, The Creepy Parlor, Just Cindy, and more. Now you won't miss an episode. Remember, follow Facebook Live and YouTube Live. Make sure you subscribe and follow your favorite WLFEDB radio shows. You can find our shows where you listen to your favorite podcasts, like Spotify, Amazon Music, iHeartRadio, and more. WLFEDB Radio is looking for podcasts to join our family. You don't have to fit any strict genre. We're a plethora of shows. If you're looking to jump on a growing network, then contact us at WLFEDBradio@gmail.com.
Wow, Amazon Music just got a whole lot better. Your favorite shows from WLFEDB Radio can now be found there. Yes, we are on Amazon Music, found under podcasts. Download the app, find podcasts, and search all of your favorite shows. Shows like Where's My Sage? Across the Pond, Everything Yet Nothing, Skeptical Help Bar, The Creepy Parlor, Just Cindy, and much more. Now you don't have to miss an episode ever. Amazon Music is WLFEDB Radio-fied.
Oh, about now. Ooh, good, 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 good to be alive right about now. Ooh, good, 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 good to be alive right about now. Hallelujah, let that bass not move ya. Say, yeah, good to be alive right about now. Ooh, I almost can I handle it? I could get used to this. I almost can I handle it? I could get used to this. I think I finally found
Welcome back. Welcome back, everyone. Guess what time it is? It's time for a little music from Bright Hawk. Here's a beautiful song with Bright Hawk.
Well, hey there, everybody. So I think you can help me with this one, because this is Rainbow Soul, and well, I believe we can make world peace a reality. So you want to make some world peace with me? It's really, really easy because, well, let's face it, you're the center of your world, just like I'm the center of mine. So when each one of us sends love out into our world, well, guess what? We make world peace a reality. So what do you say? It's a call and response, so you can sing on your own. And we can send some love around the world, love to the ones in our world, and make world peace a reality. Sounds like a good idea to me. Here we go. May all beings know peace. May all beings know peace. May all beings know love. May all beings know love. May all beings know peace. May all beings know peace. May all beings know love. May all beings know love. Healthiness and joy. Healthiness and joy. Compassion and love. Compassion and love. All together now. Love, love, love. It's what we've got for each other. Love, love, love. I hope you feel my love, love, love. To everyone in your world. Love, love, love. We each have our own world, our own bubble. My bubble, my bubble, my bubble. It's filled with love and light. Your bubble, your bubble, your bubble. It's filled with love and light. Our bubble, our bubble, our bubble. It's filled with love and light. It's filled with love and light. All together now, love, love, love. I hope you feel our love, love, love. All around the world, love, love, love. Love, love, love. We each have our own world. Our own bubble. We each have our own world, and we can make world peace together by sending out our love. Love, love, love. Just send out your love to your world. To your world. All together now. Here we go. Love, love, love. It's the best part of being love, love, love. I hope you feel our love, love, love. Love, love, love. Now, I get it that life isn't always lovely. It isn't always perfect. It isn't always easy. I'm not trying to be Pollyannish or neglect the fact that sometimes life is hard. In fact, that is why I wrote this song. This isn't just a song, this is a magical spell because, well, sometimes we have one of those days. I was having one of those days. It was the day after surgery, after I was recovering from cancer. I had a abdomen full of staples and I was supposed to walk the halls. And you might as well have told me to go play in six lanes of oncoming traffic. And I felt so vulnerable and so like, I don't know how I'm gonna do this. And so I took my little ivy tree. And I was like, okay, come on, you're an energy worker, figure it out, come on. And so I sat at the edge of my bed and held my little IV tree and I was like, okay, take a deep breath. Because whenever you're stressed, my friends, that's the first thing we stop doing. So take a deep breath. Anytime you're feeling stressed, just remember, take a deep breath. And the next thing I heard myself, literally, I heard myself saying, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble. It's filled with love and light. And then I took a step and I started my little journey down the hallway with all these people zipping by me. And I just kept saying to myself, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble. My bubble, my bubble, my bubble. It's filled with love and light. It's filled with love and light. Now you can fill your bubble with whatever you want, but I think what this bubble helps us all remember is that each one of us is in our own world. We're all having our own experience. And if you just take responsibility for your bubble, your experience, well, my friends, my friends, my friends, you will have a different experience because you will take responsibility for what is in your bubble. And you can just say to yourself, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble, my bubble. It's filled with love and light. It's filled with love and light. It's filled with love and light. Love, love, love. It's what we've got for each other. Love, love, love. I hope you feel my love, love, love. Love, love, love. Blessings to all beings. Blessings to all beings. May all beings know peace. May all beings know peace. Blessings to all beings. Blessings to all beings. May all beings know love. May all beings know love. Healthiness and joy. Healthiness and joy. Compassion and love. Compassion and love all around the world. Last time. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. All you rainbow souls, we love, love, love. And that is how you play the world peace game.
Oh, that's so awesome. I agree, Sandy. Love, love, love it. Absolutely beautiful. Thank you, Brave Hawk.
My
great
pleasure.
Job. Awesome.
I'm excited to hear from Autumn.
Now, I think we're warmed up and we're ready to hear from Autumn. I'm going to bring them back out. Here we are. Welcome back, Autumn.
Welcome. How many songs should I play? I'm gonna play some songs, like three or four.
Well, we have about 25 minutes, pretty much.
Okay, we'll see what we can do. Because we talked about this one a little bit, I'm gonna start off with Anxious Brain and My Broken Heart. Thank y'all for being here with me. I really appreciate it. My anxious brain and my broken heart called me in the covered dark. Each took its place to commiserate. And I would have been there to be in war. But I've never been so happy to be wrong. Said my anxious brain to my broken heart. Can't move forward when you're on your guard. How am I supposed to love, even open up? Oh, I can't work when I get in this space. Oh, I can't wait until I graduate.
This is her
to do that. true, I'm trying. Do that too, I'm trying. Do that too, I'm trying. Do that too. There's that one. And then the next one I'm going to do, it's a song called Do You Believe? And I sometimes play on a banjo, but guitar's a little easier for the setup today. I am writing folk music, right? And it's a fairly traditional medium. And although it's very traditional, it's pretty whitewashed and it's pretty cisgender based in a lot of markets right now and a lot of communities. And I've basically been trying to like take all the gunky stuff out of it and trying, at least in this period of my life, kind of like write from a queer perspective and try to be more purposeful about making sure that what I'm writing is diverse and open to everybody and makes everybody feel like they're wanted and important. So this is a spiritual that's non-spiritual. It's supposed to apply to everybody. Here we go. Right. Oh, here's good. Do you believe in how it once was, how we were young once and we were free? Do you still see the good that love does and how it moves us? I still believe, though there were times that I doubted everything. Now those dark days have flown away from me. I'm alright, I'll be fine, I am right. I'll be better than they ever could have seen. I'll be better than they ever could have dreamed. Yes, I'll be better than they better know. Believe. Gonna be And I Knew. And for me, I reverberate really emotionally with a lot of stuff that I write. And this one in particular just feels yellow and safe and homey. And I wrote it when I was in a really good mood and just kind of like a continuous vibe. And there's not like a typical strong structure I would normally do. Just kind of indicative of like, I was just feeling something. And this is just kind of expression of that feeling. It's like what we talked about before, where like sometimes you're just thinking something and it just like, and there it is. So this is called And I Need. Standing, I saw you standing with your back against a blue sky, and the sun did cradle your head in her arms. My body stirred. You have so much to carry. Still, you lifted me up and said, it's fine, don't you worry. 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 At all. And I knew. Yes, I knew. Oh, I knew, yes, I knew. Oh, I knew, yes, I knew. In my heart. Oh, I knew, yes, I knew. Oh, I knew, yes, I knew. Oh, I knew, yes, I knew, in my heart. Thank you.
Because I know that that's the weird part about doing online.
I know, really. Like, it's just like ghost clapping. It's so nice. It's a really nice ghost. last song of the set, and this is called LA. It's about the prospect of moving to a new place and feeling like, yay, this is a new start. And and working through a lot of life stuff too. The worst thing I ever did was try and get someone who hated me to love me. And the worst thing I ever did was try and sew a thing in a plot I knew was empty. But now I think I understand what it may take to love without sacrificing me. And I'm grateful I don't think or ever have to think twice about the picture that we've made. Now I'm having the same dream almost every day. Where I'm falling asleep and we wake up in LA. Oh, the best thing I ever did was try and be someone who I knew I could live with. And the best thing I ever did was try to be a friend and let the rest just happen. But now I think I understand what it may take to love without sacrificing me. And I'm grateful I don't blink or ever have to think twice about the picture that we've made. And now I'm having the same dream almost every day.
Well done. Well done. And Sandy was clapping too.
Sandy clapped too. Yeah, totally.
Oh, yeah.
I am totally appreciate that because.
Oh, I'm reading my comments. Oh.
Yeah, that's so sweet. Thank you, Sandy. You're such a sweet person. I appreciate you. And it's a weird thing about performing online, eh?
Yeah.
I really like that last song about the dream of waking up of us in LA.
Yeah.
That's where I grew up.
It's so beautiful, yeah. Everyone I know is like, we gotta go there because that's where the musicians go.
Oh, God. I feel like I became the musician I wanted to be when I left there.
Isn't that weird?
I personally don't have a lot of like spec in like, you know, because you move to a place, suddenly you will become, I don't know, I feel like because I didn't move there, I kind of like had to become the musician that I wanted to be. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I worked in Hollywood, but it took going to Cambridge to become the storyteller I was meant to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
Get it. I get it. Irony is everywhere.
And I was just thinking about the last time we played in LA would have been right before COVID.
We did.
When we visited a nursing home, but not a nursing home, a daycare for people with dementia.
They loved us. They loved us. It was a big hit. We were a big hit. That was, yeah. It was, you never know with what you're going to, as you know, you never know what you're going to walk into. And that was fun because they were enthusiastic and wanted to dance. Boy, you had them dancing.
Mm-hmm. So that was your last song, right? I didn't interrupt.
Yeah.
Did I?
Okay.
Okay. Great. Because I really enjoyed your music. I really personally enjoy it. I like your lyrics. I'm really drawn to your lyrics. I tend to be kind of a lyric junkie.
I mean, same. Obviously same, but yeah. But it's true. There are definitely people that I've met, all sorts of people all over the place. And there's people who are like, I just love bass, anything with bass. And like, I love drums, anything with drums. And you get people who are like, okay, that's nice lyrics, but like, where are the guitars, you know? And there's different kinds of music for every kind of person that likes different things. And that's why I'm never like, your taste in music is incorrect. Nobody's taste in music is incorrect. There's music for everybody. And, you know, the music you like will find you where you will find it.
That's right. I agree. And I enjoy acoustic guitar. My father was blind. And I also had a great relationship with my dad.
Oh, good.
So I get it. And so did she. Yeah. So there you go. And my dad used to play acoustic guitar with me and we would sing. That was how we didn't watch TV because he was blind. So most of the time he played acoustic guitar and he would sing songs to me.
Yeah.
So now that's acoustic so guitar is so soothing.
It's like a part of your life, yeah, and you're super used to it. That's so cool. That's awesome. I mean, it's probably a good thing that you didn't watch that much TV. It probably helped you, like, tap into your creativity.
Yeah, all the rest of the time when my mom and dad were divorced. So that was only on the weekends.
Oh, okay.
The rest of the time, no one cared how much TV I watched.
No,
yeah. So, you know, I had both. I knew that there was better.
Yeah. That's right.
I was privileged in that way. So what I was doing while I was listening to even Brighthawk's music, your music, and as we've been chatting, I've been shuffling tarot cards. And I'm going to do a little reading here.
Yay.
And this is the Love is Love deck. This deck is inspired... it's actually called the Pride deck. You can get it on Amazon. And every single card is done by a different LGBTQIA artist. And it's a completely collaborative deck, which is one of my favorite things to do is collaborate.
Yeah.
I find that collaboration is the key to growth and happiness in my
life. Everything. Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah.
So I've been shuffling around and asking for the cards. And right now I'm going to do a reading for everybody. And I just want you to remember that whatever I say, just take what is important to you, what speaks to your soul. Take what you like and leave the rest. Whatever other things that may not really vibrate for you, they're probably meant for somebody else. And so it's okay. Don't worry about it. Just take what you like and leave the rest. And this reading is meant for everybody watching right now, as well as those watching the recording or listening later as a podcast. If you're listening to this, it still counts even for you, because somehow I assure you the divine knew you were going to listen. And so here we are. The first card. Wow, this is such a performer card. I'm just going to say, because this character is sort of a performer in ways. You can see that they're climbing up the stairs and towards the light. And it's a performing in a way, like coming from their emotions, having dealt with their emotions, drank from each cup, and then proceeding to the light. See the light there, that sunshine up at the top of the stairs? The person is marching up the stairs. And over here is the moon. Now, the moon is all about our cycles. And if you look at the moon's face, they're kind of creepy, kind of like, I can't believe the sun is out to ruin my day or something, right? And it's an interesting card. And the reason is because this person is overcoming their cycles. And that's what this is all about. This card is that they overcame the crap that wasn't comfortable, and they did it anyway. They were scared and nervous and anxious and did it anyway. And that's what this is to remind us all. Those moments that we have overcome something, that we have drank from the cup of emotion, experienced that emotion, and gone into it anyway, gone towards the light anyway, did the hard thing. Because, you know, sometimes shining your light is one of the hardest things you'll ever do. And this card is all about right now. So that card before wasn't, this card was in the past. And that's what we've overcome, right? And this is the right now. This is all about emotion and holding our emotion, like sort of steadily, in a steady, strong way. And you can see that this person is very queer and very comfortable with who they are. But at the same time, they're also kind of cross their arms and they're on the defense. Yes. And they're also very confident. They are sure of where they are. They know where they're going and they know where they've been and they know which way to go. They are not unsure of themselves at all. They're actually feeling very sure of themselves. And if you take a look over here, there's a little love note. So this is meant to say, listen to the little messages that are coming in, the little I love yous, the little you're great, I think you're awesome. Make sure you listen to those little messages. Don't dismiss them. Take them in. Rub them around in your heart and soul. Make sure you hear them. And the next card is all about the future. This is the future. This is about receiving messages. This is about things that people would say to you or send to you, especially being the Eight of Wands. This character is, you can see that although they have the envelopes with the messages, they're hanging them out to dry. So it's not like they're opening them up or whatever. And that's what this card is all about, is handle your messages, but be sure that you do open them, because you can see that the one, she is about to take it. She's about to take it off and read it. And that's what's important. And that's what this is to remind you, is that she, and if you take a look at her, she reminds you of a famous feminist. Yeah. And it's meant to kind of remind you of that, mainly because she was a powerful, amazing woman. And you can see that it's kind of has a little bit of that Mexican background with the desert. There's a little river there. But, you know, it's meant to inspire us to step forward, receive your messages, and take them in. Keep them. keep the messages that are coming to you, especially positive messages that are, that people are pouring at you, that they're saying, hey, we love you. We appreciate you. I appreciate what you did. Thank you for doing this today. Whatever it was, make sure you're hearing those messages and make sure you're saving them for tomorrow or hanging them out to dry, so that you still have them tomorrow. And that's what this is all about. So I just want to say that the cards are telling you to keep moving through the light. This is a reminder of your ability to overcome emotion and overcome even not so great messages, from the moon, and to keep going towards the light anyway, even when you are nervous and anxious. And this card right here is a fantastic card about being confident where you are. Don't be afraid to be confident. It's okay. Stand firm where you are right now and keep moving forward and harvest those messages. Keep them in your heart and soul. Harvest them and stand up for who you are. Be who you are. Be fully and totally who you are. And in that, my friends, I want to thank you for watching Rainbow Soul. Thank you, Autumn. Thank you, Bright Hawk,
pleasure,
for being on the show today and doing this with me as a beautiful gift to our community, to our LGBTQIA community, that if you're a musician, if you're playing around with your guitar and lyrics, keep doing it. We need you. We need your message.
Yeah, we need more of them.
Yeah, sure. We need more non-binary musicians. We need more queer musicians. We need more people to bring their message to the world. Your message is important too. We value you. We love you just the way you are, and know that you are loved regardless of anything else. You are loved. There are not bad people. There are only bad actions. So you are you, and we love you just the way you are. So thank you all for watching, and thank you both for being here with me today, and thank you to the audience.
So much. Oh yeah, thank the audience too.
Thank you to all the viewers that have watched, and we love you and appreciate you. Come back every Sunday. Every Sunday, Rainbow Soul is putting it on. We have all kinds of fun topics. And I want to remind you that we are just starting to kick off Rainbow Soul's clothing line.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, yes. You yourself can have a t-shirt that says, not because non-binary is sacred, or because queer is sacred, because transgender is sacred. All of the special, all of the different identities are represented, or most of them are. And along with lots of other very cool t-shirts and all kinds of great stuff. So check out our new clothing line, and we'll be bringing that in more next week. And next week, we are going to have a very special person on that we're going to be talking to LGBTQ. She's a LGBTQ activist, and we're going to be talking to her about all of the ways that we can do activism. And I think we're going to have some people at least joining us in the audience that will be from Africa, that are LGBTQIA, that are that don't have their rights right now. And we are going to honor them and pray for them. So I hope you can be here next week with Rusty Rose. All right, my friends.
Cool.
Good night. We love you.
Good night.
See you next week.
Thank you for watching Rainbow Soul, part of the WLFE DB Network, a queer perspective on spirituality beyond religion. We appreciate you sharing the show on your timeline. Follow us on social media of your choice, and join our Facebook group, Rainbow Soul. We want to hear from you. Share your topic ideas for Hollis and LaCrosse. Explore upcoming shows and interesting guests. The Rainbow Soul Facebook group, where we build community of questioning seekers. Rainbow Soul, where spirituality is our medicine.